Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Not far from my house.
Our meeting is now called to order, and at this time, I'm going to ask Ms. Vaughn for the invocation, please.
Before I go to that, I would like to say a very happy Easter to our friends that are members of the Orthodox Church. May sound like it's a day late, but I assume that Easter Monday is the same for them that it was for the rest of us a week ago. I have invited Reverend Emmett Floyd to give the invocation, if you would, sir. Thank you.
Let us pray. O Eternal Spirit, we would pause to ask for your wisdom as we have the freedom to make choices that affect the lives of all of your children here and everywhere. We remember especially those who are going through difficult times during these days and pray that they may receive not only aid from on high, but the support of friends and neighbors. Enable the President of the United States and all of those in positions of leadership to have the wisdom and courage to make those decisions that are best for all of your children. So we commit the lives of all children and all people everywhere into your great keeping. In your holy name, amen.
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 Thank you. The next thing, I'm going to move number four up. We do have a certificate of commendation, and I want to do that before the public comment because I have quite a few names. So we're going to just switch out number four on our agenda. And at this time, I'm going to call on Dan Engel to present this this commendation, please.
I'll ask Deputy Scott Gaither if he'd meet me at the podium, please. Back on December the 7th of 2008, Bobby Taylor, who was a businessman in eastern Guilford County, he was a retired captain with the Greensboro Fire Department, was tragically killed at his place of business. Subsequently, this young man standing to his right made a traffic stop here in Alamance County. Now, I can't really get into the specifics because this case is still pending in court, but I will tell you this. He used his training and experience and made all the right decisions, and because of him, subsequently, this case was cleared. So on behalf of the, and let me read this to you, on behalf of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, we proudly present this certificate of commendation, which expresses deep and sincere appreciation to Scott A. Gaither for his dedication to the citizens of North Carolina, especially in the case involving the robbery and murder of Bobby Lee Taylor on December 7th, 2008, presented this 20th day of April, 2009. And again, I want to thank you for a job well done, and this is signed by all the commissioners. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. My mother and father, Henry and Catherine Gaither, and my grandparents, Henry Sr. and Jane Gaither, back and back, and my little sister Caroline's back there. So thank you all for everything.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, the next we're going to have public comments, and I'll start with Brenda Everett.
Good evening. I am Brenda Everett, and from Pleasant Grove, and we were asked to come back tonight to hear what Mr. Haygood had to say about he was going to do to the Recreation Department. And you assured me last time that it would be fixed, maybe not the way it was. I pray that it will be even better than what it was before, where we can go back and enjoy our fellowship and our games and the rec ball and everything. So I thought I would be speaking after he made his comment to see what we were up against. So,
well, we just got that, and I just saw it too. So I'm not sure exactly, but hopefully he will tell you something good.
Okay, thank you.
I knew it. Thank you, Brenda. Margaret Dameron.
I'm Margaret Dameron, and you have to bear with me. I'm just getting over pneumonia.
Sorry.
Me too. I like to die. This is on the articles I've been reading in the paper. I tell you, the way I feel, and I hope the people of Alamance County will stand together and wash the yellow streak off of our backs and take our county back from the ACLU. I think we need to tell them to take a hike. If nobody else is willing, I am. Because you can go down Mebane Street, and any time just about you want to, there's somebody turning right on a no-turn red light. And if you look to see who it is, you can understand why they're stopped. Just like at Come Park Plaza, you can be sitting there sometime, and they'll take a left on a red light. I guess they get tired of sitting there waiting. But anyway, I don't like it. I think it's costing the Sheriff Department money, costing Alamance County money, and it's taking up all their time. And we need them to be doing other things and not what they're putting them through. I don't know how anybody else feels, but that's the way I feel. And most of my family feels the same way, and other people, too, that I have talked to. So, isn't it something we can do to, instead of costing the Sheriff's Department all that much money and all that paperwork, isn't it something you can do to help them?
Well, we're not here to answer questions, Margaret. I'm sorry, but go ahead and make your comments. Okay. But I think you'll hear something later.
You think so?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I hope I don't get too impatient before that happens.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. First of all, I forgot to remind everybody they have 3 minutes up here, okay? So I do want to just say that right now. Albert Handy. Hey, Mr. Handy.
Hi, I'm Albert Handy, and I was here in the last meeting, and I talked with you, Linda, about the agenda to see if we could come up with some other way as far as having it just rather on the website so that everybody in Alamance County could know what was going on in each meeting. And I've seen what's published already in the last few weeks. It's been a lot of help to the individuals. I've had people to call me and tell me, you know, have you read the paper, you know? So I was just wondering maybe if there's some other way that we could come up with.
I think we probably need to turn that over to Scott and, you know, and let them, because we can't, you know.
Right.
I couldn't find it if I wanted to. I can find the website, but, you know, we can present that to Scott if...
You don't think it's possible Data Time News or Alamance News?
I don't even know who to address that to at this point. Is that
probably
the county manager? We can address that. What he's asking is about putting our agenda either in the Times News every week or on a website or whatever, okay?
We'll be glad to look at that and bring you back a recommendation.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ben Ansbacher. Ansbacher, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Good.
Good evening. Again, I would like to compliment you on having this comment session, which I think is unusual for a public governing body, but I think it's very worthwhile, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you all. I'm a little out of sequence because I want to speak about what the motion that I think Ann Vaughn is going to make on auditing the 287G program. And I would like to say the word audit to me implies some financial investigation, and I think that should be part of any audit if it is undertaken. Then the public, at least the public I talk to, there are a lot of questions about, is this program really making money? Is the county having to pay to house potential detainees before they become paying ICE detainees? And we also want to know what expenses are incurred in the program. When your auditor made her report, she complimented the sheriff on raising $4 million. It wasn't said whether that was net or gross. And I think we would like to know that. And when figuring what costs to subtract to bring it down to net, we'd like to have confidence that all the costs have been included, not perhaps just some that are on a certain category in your budget.
Well, I think if you will go to the sheriff, he will give you that information.
Well, this should come from the finance office, I would think.
Well, or then go to Amy and she can give you that information.
Thank you.
Okay. She should be able to do that. If she can't, we'll work on it. Thank you. Ed Hsu?
Good evening, Madam Chair, Commissioners. Pardon me, I can't keep up with details, so I had to write a little bit tonight, and I'll generally speak off the cuff. I want to bring you tonight a recap of the past few months, so I ask you to bear with me. On February the 2nd, 2009, Sheriff Johnson gave a statistical report regarding traffic stops and listed seven counties and cities: Alamance, Orange, Chatham County, Broughton PD, Graham PD, Randolph County, and Chapel Hill PD, and their statistics. As he began his report, he stated, and I quote from the County Commissioner's video, about 68 minutes and 24 seconds into it, Sheriff Johnson said two things. When we stop a car and we write a ticket, there is no form filled out. Because the information in Raleigh is taken from that ticket to give you race, gender, and all kinds of data of that traffic stop. Secondly, he said, if we do not give you a ticket, a form is filled out. And that got a timestamp. I would like to bring to your attention GS 114-10.1 that states, a traffic stop form will be filled out for all stops, whether the citation was issued or not. I have left you copies of that statute. Moving forward to April the 5th, 2009, a Times News article of that same report says 850 more Hispanics were stopped and ticketed compared to the sheriff's report of 494. In between the above dates, the sheriff faces having to make copies of all sorts of reports for the ACLU, which has already been mentioned. On April the 6th, 2009, Sheriff Johnson, at 25 minutes and 59 seconds in the county commissioner's video, had Chief Deputy Britt give an update on found traffic stops and found errors. This from that video at 26 minutes and 35 seconds. Mr. Britt's explanation for this, that it was due to software, computer problems, and human error. Mr. Britt also stated at 32 minutes and 55 seconds, our stop percentages will fall within inside the lowest and highest of some of our local folks. And he said at 33 minutes and 1 second, I still think we will be within 4% of total stop data. At this time, I, Ed Hsu, would like to point out that traffic stop form information is entered directly into SPI being via the internet and not through a software program. This information is gathered from local law enforcement agencies. That part, I have no way of knowing it.
Ed, your 3 minutes are up, sir.
My 3 minutes is up? Mm-hmm. I can't read very fast. Well, you've got the rest of it, and I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Rusty Isley?
Thank you. Mr. Austin, how are you?
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm just here with one quick question. We have been with the county fire, and we have been told that there's a carnival setting up at Western Electric. We were told 2 weeks ago that Sheriff Johnson was stopping anything because he has to sign a permit. And according to the statute, no amusements, circuses, or any type of amusements can be set up 30 days prior to a scheduled Alamance County fire. We've got signs across the county. They've been up since April the 5th. And we're wondering how this carnival can show up. Who is responsible for signing or issuing the okay for them to have it when they have to have a permit from the sheriff, and the sheriff says he's not giving one?
If you will get with Mr. Albright after this is over, I've talked with Mr. Albright. Mr. Albright, you've talked with
sure.
him when we get through for a few minutes, and probably right before we go into closed session and talk to Mr. Albright about
that. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Robert Simpson.
Madam Chairman, thank you. One brief comment. 2,000 years ago, the Pharisees and the Sadducees persecuted Jesus as he went about to do his job. 2,000 years later, the modern-day Pharisees and Sadducees and UNC professors and Elon professors and Bens and Eddies and elected officials are persecuting our good sheriff. And I think y'all will lay off.
Hannah Gill. Ms. Gill, how are you?
Good evening. Good evening to you all. I'm here tonight to address the two resolutions that were put forward in the paper this weekend. I want to make a couple points on 287G, these resolutions. The first resolution that Commissioner Vaughn is going to put forward to seek outside inquiry into the 287G program, I support. And I think that the way to take our county back is to prove that there's nothing been going wrong with the Sheriff's Department. And I think that if there's nothing to hide, then what's the problem in investigating? I also think that the commissioners have called investigations into social services and the health department. It's really hypocritical to not investigate legitimate concerns in the Sheriff's Department. I finally want to address the other resolution that's supposed to be put forward tonight, that to expand the 287G program to its full capacities. I'm curious what that means, because they're already being expanded to their full capacities. People are being arrested and deported for fishing without a license, so I don't really know how it can get worse. The sheriff and his deputies in the field, they ought to know that whatever sentiment is expressed by such a resolution, should it pass, it's symbolic. It doesn't really have any legal teeth, because MOAs are an agreement between ICE. So ICE has to agree to take part in this. So whatever resolution is passed tonight is pretty much symbolic. And I want to really impress to you that this resolution will further divide our community that is already divided. I think it is time for us to come together and stop coming up with incendiary resolutions to further marginalize very vulnerable people in our community. So I think I'm here for a call for respectful dialogue. One of the suggestions I have is even putting together a task force of people who can address these concerns, the many different concerns that have been going on outside of the county commissioner meetings, because they're not really necessarily productive, I don't think. We're not really getting anywhere on these issues. And I think that's pretty much all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. I think this is Tom Balkin.
I think you're right. The name is Tom Balkin.
Okay, Balkin.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'd like to cede my time to Steve Carter, if I may. Would you let me do that, please?
That's fine.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Tom and I were talking while we were in there, and I explained a situation that had occurred with
me. That's Steve Carter.
Steve Carter.
Okay, Steve Carter.
Yes, ma'am.
I got you.
I'd about 3312 Doral Court in Burlington. I don't remember the exact date. I didn't come planning to speak tonight, but about 4 years ago, I was rear-ended on Church Street one night. My wife and I were leaving T for two, and turned out the individual who rear-ended us was Hispanic, was drunk. Both of the individuals in the car were drunk. Didn't have a license, as best I can recall. I didn't do any research, so I don't remember all the details, but I'm going by what the officer told me at the time. And conveniently to him, no insurance. And all the rhetoric that's come out recently about why the number of Hispanics are being stopped in our county doesn't surprise me if you think about the fact that the number of illegals that we have in the county relative to the rest of the community, that the numbers could appear to be skewed simply because if they aren't taking the time to learn how to drive in North Carolina, pass the driving test, and get a license, they don't know our laws. If they don't know our laws, they break the law. The probability then is they're going to get stopped more frequently than I am, who'm trying to follow the laws. I think our sheriff's doing a great job. I think we ought to leave him alone and let him do it, move on and get something done productive in our county. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, that is all of the public comments, and so we're going to move to the 2010 U.S. Census Complete Count Committee, and at this point in time, I will recognize Catherine Murphy, who is with the U.S. Census Bureau.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Commissioners, County Manager Huckabee, and Assistant Manager Burgess. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to be here this evening. Again, my name is Kathy Murphy. I'm a partnership specialist with the U.S. Census Bureau. As many of you know, the 2010 census is currently underway. You may have seen our canvassers out in your community. They were deployed the beginning of April and have a big job to do. We have from now until next April to accomplish our mission. That is to count everyone living in the United States once and at the right location. This mission is critical as the final count determines federal appropriations, money that flows back into our communities in the form of benefits, money for schools, daycare centers, hospitals, road infrastructures, and other municipal projects. The count also determines congressional reapportionment. During the last census, that would be 2000, North Carolina picked up an extra congressional seat due to its ever-expanding population. My role with the Bureau is outreach, to raise awareness for the upcoming decennial and to encourage participation so that we increase the mail-in response rate when questionnaires go out next March. I'm reaching out to trusted voices in the community to assist us with this process, i.e. government agencies, elected officials, faith-based organizations, educators, business and community leaders. My district includes Alamance, Caswell, Davidson, Davie, Forsyth, Guilford, Rockingham, and Stokes counties. As you can imagine, we are facing many challenges throughout this process. Historically, 60% of the population returns their questionnaires. The other 40% who do not participate generally don't know enough about the process or why it's important, or they're simply fearful of that process. That is why I'm here this evening, to convey to you how difficult the process is and why I must appeal to you for your help in reaching the hard-to-count segments of our population, because the result of this operation impacts us all. I urge you to promote the census on your respective websites, in your newsletters, your lobbies, your marquees, at public events, or to form a complete count committee. The complete count committees are comprised of community leaders whose primary focus is to educate, promote, and to motivate. It is a major vehicle for planning and implementing local targeted efforts that will uniquely address the special characteristics of your respective communities. The Bureau cannot accomplish this mission without you. By reaching out to all of you, you help us get the message out exponentially. I'd like to close, especially, I think, poignant tonight in this room. Let me close with this comment. The message is simple. If you're living in this country, you're driving on our roads. You're a member, or your family may be attending our schools and our churches. You're using our hospitals, our healthcare systems. You may even be receiving social services. In order to distribute benefits and services equitably throughout the land, we need to know who is living in this country, regardless of residency status. The Census Bureau needs an accurate count in order to fulfill its mission. That is to deliver an official head count of the U.S. population to the President on December 31st, 2010. This is a federal mandate, and we need your support. And I like to refer to this whole operation as democracy in action, and hope that we can rely upon you. For additional information, I encourage you to visit our website at 2010census.gov. That's all I have to add this evening. Thank you very much.
Anybody have any questions for Ms. Murphy at this time? Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Okay, the next thing on our agenda is Mr. Haygood, who is going to talk about the Pleasant Grove Recreation Center update. How are you, Mr. Bryan?
Good evening, Commissioner.
Good evening.
I'm here this evening. I was here last meeting. We had a lot of questions from community residents about Pleasant Grove Recreation Center. I know this board's been presented a petition from numerous residents from Pleasant Grove about the building and what's going on. So I thought tonight would be ample time to give you an update. I need to give you a briefing, kind of some history of the property, talk to you a little bit about that, and tell you about finances and where we seem to be right now. So with no further ado, I'll begin. The Pleasant Grove Recreation Center, this property, the building consists of over 17,000 square feet and sits on 28 acres that we run as a passive use park. We have some ball fields out there, walking track, playground equipment. The building itself consists of a gymnasium, several classrooms and activity spaces, offices for the Northern Division staff for our department, numerous restrooms. This property is a former Alamance County school system site that was vacated in the early 1970s. And Alamance County has leased this property for recreational use for over 30 years. Well, hope you have the handout in front of you. I'll get mine out.
And we'll talk about that. Yeah.
Sure, what happened there? Very well. Now, we currently have the property leased until 2012. Even in its current state. If you flip to the next page, I'll just walk right through this. Pleasant Grove is the largest and most intricate facility the County Recreation Department operates. We don't have anything close to the scale with internal systems, nothing. This is the biggest and most involved property we have. For history's sake, and to kind of give you some insight, in 2005, our department did a capital needs assessment of Pleasant Grove and many of our properties. At that time, there was some indication that the county was going to fund some capital improvement projects.
There we are.
The ghost in the building.
At that time, in 2005, we went through Pleasant Grove very thoroughly and determined there was a need for about $190,000 worth of capital repair in 2005. We've been operating the property for years under a lease and had made very little large capital investment in the property. So in the 2005-2006 capital improvement plan, which is a CIP, we put the Pleasant Grove building into that plan. We asked the county to consider it for funding. The department entered 11 projects at that time into the CIP, and we ranked Pleasant Grove and its needs as number one problem that we had in 2005-2006. Now, for history's sake, the county has been reluctant to fund major renovations at Pleasant Grove for two reasons. One is that Pleasant Grove is a leased property. The county does not own the property. It's owned, we're under a 90-day notice to vacate. So we don't own it, but we are responsible for all utilities, capital repair, maintenance, and operations. So there's been a reluctance to pour a lot of money into Pleasant Grove with that arrangement. Also, it's owned by Alamance Burlington School System. And the county, of course, is responsible to also fund renovations to active ABSS sites. Pleasant Grove is an inactive site and has been since the early 1970s. So there's a lot of needs at active school system sites. It's never been a high priority for funding. So based on the fact that we were needing some significant capital repair and the fact that it appeared to be difficult to acquire those funds based on the arrangements the county has, We went through a master plan process in 2007, and the following recommendations were made: that the Pleasant Grove Recreation Facility should be replaced for program purposes with arrangements made with either the town of Green Level or the city of Meadow. Now, those two jurisdictions, you could easily substitute other community resources, basically, somewhere else in the community to provide the program. At no time, I want to stress to the board, we put a lot of value on the programs and the activities that happen at Pleasant Grove. When we went through the master plan process, those programs retained their high value with the department. The problem was, are we going to be able to continue to do that at Pleasant Grove for years and years and years? We didn't believe so at the time. It was also recommended in the department's long-range plan that we should formalize some type of agreement with Alamance-Berlin School System to use active sites, now, namely Pleasant Grove Elementary School, which is located about 2 miles from this property. So, through June 9, 2008, fire broke out at Pleasant Grove Recreation Center. The center has been closed since that time. The department staff immediately, they too, began working very hard to relocate the programs and staff offices. You guys, I've met with you repeatedly and briefed you about these things. The summer camp was moved to Pleasant Grove Elementary School, where it will take place again this year. Senior bingos and potluck lunches and the offices for the staff were relocated to Lakeview Civitan Club. The basketball program for kids, including their games and practices, were relocated to Pleasant Grove Elementary School and Hall River Elementary School as well. Hall River is a little bit further than the Pleasant Grove gym. We have lost the ability to provide, open gym because of the loss of the gymnasium. The exercise room, it was very popular with our community residents to come in, open 5 days a week and use it to work out, as well as we had a every Friday night dance, Big Daddy's Dance, that occurred at the property. The family bingo night, we have not reestablished that program. However, once we moved into Lakeview, which was end of January, we wanted to get a couple of weeks under our belt. We are planning to bring that program back. We are going to offer it at Lakeview, but we wanted to. Lakeview's been great. They've been very accommodating, but before we totally inundated them with our programs, we wanted to have some time working. So out of those programs, at this time, today, open gym, the exercise room capability, and the Big Daddy's Dance have been lost, and we've been unable to replace those programs. Quickly, I want to go over the current money situation, the current funds, the finance situation. The county's insurance company has estimated the renovations to take the property, the building, back to its pre-fire condition. The cost is estimated by our insurance company to be $218,000 plus. That, of course, is if you take away a deductible, the county carried a $25,000 deductible on the property, and depreciation, which is $39,787, you come to $153,408. That is what the insurance company has sent Alamance County to put toward renovation of Pleasant Grove Recreation Center at this time, today. Okay. Content loss, we lost a great deal of supplies and equipment during this fire. Some was to fire, a lot of it was to smoke and soot damage. We have estimated the content loss to be a little over $73,000. The insurance companies reviewed our estimates and arrived at a $19,000 figure. It's a pretty large disparity between our estimates and the insurance. So at this time, I'm going to present to you three options. The reason I'm presenting these is because I have figures for these three options. And I'll talk a little bit about what you may want to consider at the very end of this brief presentation. The county has entered into agreement with Routon, Nickerson, DeLuca, who are doing our $10 million capital project, to handle and work with the county to determine what kind of scope of work is going to be done at Pleasant Grove. So the same architects, not as a part of the $10 million project, but as a part of this insurance project, are looking at Pleasant Grove with the county to help us deal with the insurance company. The county's architecture firm estimates that to get the property back to, just to get the doors open, pre-fire, is $295,000 plus. Now, that does include new electrical wiring. That's a significant difference than what the insurance company is estimating. The county's architect feels like that is the way to go, is to replace the wiring rather than try to use some that may or may not have been heat damaged. Also, I've worked with the MIS department and the county fire marshal's office. We're going to be required to put in some type of code-compliant fire alarm system in this building. We had a very dated system that, as you know, rang the bell basically on the outside of the property. In order to do this, I worked with MIS and Fire Marshal. We had Eastern Data come out, and just for a benchmark, this is not a final figure of what it would cost, but for a benchmark, we would be looking at around $40,000, $42,868 to put in a system that CECOM would monitor, which they're now capable of doing for fire prevention. Total cost, the architects are estimating $338,328 to get us back to just pre-fire, to reopen the doors on the building. If you include the money that the insurance company has sent, I've also included the depreciation, because once we make repairs, we will get the money, the $39,000 depreciation money back. The county at this, for this scenario, would have to contribute $145,000 of county funds. This is not insurance money. This would be county money on top of insurance money and the depreciation. Downside to this scenario, from the department standpoint, is it does leave us with most of the original existing capital problems that we had and we identified in 2005. Those will not be addressed with this scenario. Doors open, still capital problems. I call this pre-fire plus. Architects estimate, you see the number, $543,000 to reopen the center with two improvements to the property that will address some of the concerns from the 2005 capital assessment. One is the ceilings are going to be replaced out of Pleasant Grove, but what we have was just sheetrock nailed to the wood. There was no insulation or anything like that. And it also has very, very high ceilings in all space. Now, obviously in the gym, but in the classrooms and all, we really don't need it. The architects have recommended that they would come in with lay-in ceilings that would reduce the volume of the rooms. Idea being it would make it cheaper to heat and cool. Also, the architects recommend two separate HVAC systems, one for each wing. It would be roof mounted. We are currently using the boiler system. The heat system at Pleasant Grove was originally steam boiler. Portions of it have failed all throughout the property. We have just been cutting them off as they fail, installing usually an electric heater, something along those lines. And we're also using about 12 window ACs right now to cool the building. Architects said, hey, if you're going to make an investment in the property, you need to consider putting in, let the boiler system heat the gym only, no air conditioning for the gym, two separate HVAC systems. Architects also recommend that we consider replacement windows for the property. The windows are the original windows, and they are in very poor shape. And for an efficiency standpoint, it would be wise to consider that. This still leaves numerous capital problems at the property. This does not, even at a $543,000 level, solve all capital problems. Does get the doors back open. It will run in this scenario much more efficient than what it does now. We will have problems that will continue that have already been cataloged, restrooms, doors. The total cost to the county in this scenario, $350,601. This is taking the money from the insurance company and depreciation. The county's contribution would be $356,001. Final option that I'm tonight prepared to bring to your attention is to operate as we have been planned. Which is follow the recommendations from the master plan. We will continue to use Pleasant Grove Elementary for summer camp, youth basketball, possibly open gym through some type of joint use agreement with the school system. We would continue to use Lakeview for the senior and family programs. But in this scenario, the department would lose the ability to host the dances. That we just can't find space suitable to bring that program back. And the exercise room, it may be possible somewhere in the community to find space that we could put the equipment. That is possible. I'm not going to rule it out, but we wouldn't have it at Lakeview or obviously at schools. This is what we are currently doing. We are offering almost all the programs, but not at the prom. I want to stress to the board and to the community, because I know we have folks here, and I'm glad they're here, because that's, to me, that is a reflection that they have benefited from the service that's been provided at Pleasant Grove. And I'm glad that they feel strongly enough about what we do to come and make their feelings known to this board. We do remain committed to providing service at the site. We can provide service there through the renovated building or not. We provide service with just the grounds as well. There are a lot of different options besides these two, but I just have figures for these. We have talked about the possibility of only restoring a portion of the building, and maybe doing some type of new construction that would be small, catered specifically to the type of programs that we are currently offering. We can continue to entertain those. I don't have figures for that. The architect can provide those figures, but that was not in their original scope. Their original scope was come in, look at the whole property, see how the insurance estimate plays with what they think should work. They've assured me they can do it, but it's going to take some type of renewed agreement with the architect firm for them to start talking about maybe just the gym and some new space or new space on the property. But that would be at the discretion of the board. I've talked with the county manager. We discussed the possibility that you may want to, and I know we're coming up, we've been closed for a long time. It wasn't great. But this board may want to consider forming some type of community group to discuss priorities. What I have, what I've been presented with is an outspoken desire from the community to keep the original building in its total, complete way it sits right now. That will be costly to do. I think there are other ways to provide the service on the same property, the same 28 acres, but the community right now has said we want it back. We want the very building back. There may be some benefit in discussing that idea with them to say, how would you feel about certain parts of the building being renovated, some not, the possibility of some new construction, some not. I agree with the manager, I believe it is worth pursuing, but it would take, we would have to get some people involved with that, and I would recommend possibly someone from this board that may have some interest in one meeting. We want to be quick about this, obviously. But we think maybe one to two at the most meetings could do this. We probably need representation from Alamance-Brown School System. It is their property. No matter what the county decides to do, renovate it all, renovate it partially, it will have to be presented to them. The building belongs to them. Obviously, someone from our staff, our Parks Commission, and without question, people from the community should have an opportunity to give some input. Maybe try to come to some type of consensus about how dedicated the community is to the very building where they've been coming for this property, if that's the only way they want to see it return. So at this point, I know that was a very quick fly through, but I'll certainly try to answer any questions I can get.
Could we not have, since I'm on your board, basically, your liaison or however you want to call me, could we not bring some of those into one of the meetings there?
Absolutely.
And that way we wouldn't have to do a separate meeting. And then if we wanted one other person here that would go, I'm going to be there. And
I think that's a great idea. We would have Mr. Evans from Alamance-Brown School System is also on the board. And
yeah, he is also on our board. Yeah.
And we would want to make sure that the community knows the date and when that agenda will be, when we'll be talking about it. If we do that, we might can look at maybe hosting it somewhere else, because I would expect a pretty good crowd from Pleasant Grove.
Because your little place is a little bit smaller. And I mean, we could actually, I guess, maybe have it here because it's on Tuesday night.
Yes.
So, and just think about that and just talk with Mr. Duncutt and see what we can do with that. And also, Dan.
Yeah. If we're going to look at renovating that building, why don't we discuss with ABSS the possibility of them turning that land over to us or sell it to us? Before we put money into it. I think we need to do that.
And that would be maybe a topic for discussion at this meeting. And I think that would certainly warrant someone maybe from central office to be there too to provide insight.
Okay. Isn't there a ball field up there?
There is. There's two ball fields. Both are only one is lit, and no restrooms or concessions. It's very basic setup. Yes.
Who maintains that?
We do.
With the repairs that you're estimating here, at the ultimate, the highest, this is the roof. Would the roof be good for how many years?
Hesitate to tell you. We have had roof work done on the flat portion of the roof that covers the two wings. We had some significant leaks several years ago. The dome part over the gym, to my knowledge, since it has not been done in many, many years. We have had some leak issues with it too. I'm not sure.
None of those repairs are in these figures.
No, there'll be no roof work is estimated here. We have done some
to fix that part of the fire damage. Yeah.
That's correct. The fire department did have to remove two sections. That's been capped, and obviously would be a part of replacement.
What's the square footage of the complex?
I'm sorry?
The square footage of the complex.
It's a little over 17,000. It's right at 17,500. That's total. That's gymnasium and the two wings.
So the ultimate is about $20 a square foot to take it back to its original status.
Yeah, I didn't run those numbers, but if was that based on the first option, the 295?
I might be wrong. Is that not correct?
Depending on which option.
Yeah, 350,000. Yeah. About $20 square foot. Is that a wood floor or a tile floor for the gym?
It was a tile floor. We've had removed the tile. All came up after the fire. I don't know if it was a combination of heat and the water from the fire department just cooked all the mastic. That had to be abated. It was asbestos. So the county has gone ahead and abated it. It's now just back to the slab. I did talk with the architect about the type of floor. They recommended going back with some PC tile type. They're not going back with a wood. Originally, the facility had a wood floor. And apparently at some point, it was filled. The crawl space was filled and then with dirt and then it was slabbed. In all these scenarios, we would be going back with tile.
I like to make a comment about it. I did go out and look through the building with Brian and back when they were working with the insurance company and everything, and we found one of the books out there where people sign in their usage. They get a lot of usage out there on that building. And I had one other question there, Brian. On the dance, do you not charge for that, or isn't there a charge?
We
generate a little bit of revenue.
We do generate revenue. We have a flat fee with the group that puts the dance on, and then they do charge a fee to get
so
in.
Do make some revenue.
It's been a very popular program. It has brought folks to Pleasant Grove over. They've been out there almost 5 years now. It has brought folks to Pleasant Grove that normally probably wouldn't come of the facility, and what we found is they've become more aware of the other programs that we've got while they're there for the dance, and they take advantage. Please let me stress that these are good programs. These folks come and take advantage of them. We're very glad that we do. That's why there's been so much effort, not by me, but by my staff, to keep them going, and they have been able to. Yes, ma'am.
Brian, I wanted to ask you, as far as ABSS is concerned, and this is their building.
Yes, ma'am.
How do they feel about the renovations or what the insurance is paying and what we're expected to pay to get that building back to where ABSS had it?
We've had, from day one of the fire, we had numerous conversations with ABSS about it. Actually took some work with finance and the legal department to line up the county being able to go in there and authorized work to be done. ABSS has owned this property for a long time. They know that we operate it for rec use. My conversations with staff from central office have been, I believe they would be supportive of renovation works that we would do. Without doubt, it would need to come before them in some way to tell them what the county's plans are. We've not known until we didn't get these figures. We got these figures from the architect back in March 18th. So we really didn't have an idea of what the county's contribution from its own funds might be. The insurance company just recently sent another general contractor out to the property. He toured it again. We thought that they may adjust the amount of money that they were going to send the county. They did not. So we feel like that may be what we can expect to get from them.
There was one thing on the supply part. Have you discussed this with them, Clyde, about getting that amount? I'm looking about, $54,000 difference, what you accounted for and what the insurance company is willing to pay.
I'm working closely with Rhonda Morkel with the finance department to get those justified. What we have done is we went in and looked at everything in there that we felt like could be qualified as a loss. A lot of things are quite obvious. Some things are not so obvious. The scoreboard in the gym, for example. Scoreboard in the gym is an electronic component. We maintenance brought a generator out. We plugged it up. The thing works, but we know it's been contaminated with smoke and soot. It needs at the minimum to be clean. We're listing it as a loss until it's clean, because my fear would be in a year from now we're going to plug that thing in and it's not going to work, and we're going to be getting another $8,000 unit. I think tonight, once we have a clearer idea from this board, and it sounds like, I'll make sure I understand, you're interested in our department perhaps through one of our Parks Commission meetings, inviting people to come in and talk a little bit about their willingness to think about other possible scenarios at the building. And then I'll be getting with Rhonda this week, too. Some of the things that they did that we had some questions about, they depreciated some of the electronic value, which they're not supposed to do by the terms. I think, and we've had significant amounts of the items cleaned, too. I know exercise treadmills, electronic treadmills, electronic bikes, those have been cleaned. But I think hopefully we'll be able to come to terms with them on some of these other prices.
There's some seniors that want that exercise equipment back yesterday.
Yes. I'd like to make one more comment. If it's at $20 a square foot to repair, and if you rebuilt it, you know, it'd be five times that amount, $100 a square foot. And so, you know, I think that those prices sound pretty good to me. But I would definitely, everyone who meets with the group and you as well, if we have roof repair that need to be done up there, we need to incorporate that in the deal, in my opinion, because it'd be silly to have to go back a year for later to fix the roof.
I agree. And that would be, I think we would want to look at what the community is interested in, because frankly, when you get into the $500,000 level, it's possible you could come back, renovate the gym, and put a nice new space, more streamlined and efficient, heat pump, cool, those things on the property. Yeah. But we want to hear if that will work for them or if the absolute commitment is to the building as it stands. You can, like I say, when you get to that level of funding, you really can, there's a lot of nice things you can do, too.
Yes, a lot of space in there, behind there when you're going in where the dance was.
Yes. Okay. Well, then I'll take it as a charge for our office to.
And I would add to the, Madam Chair, I would volunteer to be on that committee if you need it.
That would be great. Well, then we'll select a date and make that an item on the Parks Commission agenda, and we'll let the public know. We'll make sure and let you know, too, Commissioner.
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay. The next, I'm going to recognize Ms. Maul and for her discussion, a possible review of the Sheriff's Department.
Okay, I want to start off with saying that this is not anything going against the sheriff. When I've had disagreements with him before, and we've had disagreements, I've come to him, and he knows that. I do support the 287G program and its concept. And I believe in the rule of law. But I've done a lot of checking. I've heard a lot of things. You know, when your family and friends from across this country call and say, "Ann, you live in Alamance County, what's going on?" And I hedge. Be honest, I hedge. One cousin in California was pretty specific, and my phone went out. The battery went dead right in the middle of that conversation, so I couldn't answer any questions. And I think that was probably on purpose. And I didn't want to. I went to the GAO, Government Accountability Office, and found some interesting information. And this is not against the sheriff. So before anybody gets all upset, and I've heard some of the things that have been said, I want you to relax. I want you to hear what I have to say. And this is a report from GAO. ICE has designed some management controls to govern 287G program implementation, such as MOAs and background checks of state and local officers, but the program lacks other controls, which makes it difficult for ICE to ensure that the program is operating as intended. First, the program lacks documented program objectives to help ensure that participants work toward a consistent purpose. ICE officials stated that the objective of the program is to address serious crimes, such as narcotics smuggling committed by removable aliens. However, ICE has not documented this objective in program materials. As a result of 29 program participants reviewed by GAO, four used 287G authority to process individuals for minor crimes, such as speeding, contrary to the objective of the program. Second, ICE has not described the nature and extent of its supervision over participating agencies' implementation of the program, which has led to wide variation in perception of the nature and extent of the supervisory responsibility among ICE field officials and officials from the participating agencies. ICE is statutorily required to supervise agencies participating in the 287G program, and internal control standards require an agency's organizational structure to clearly define key areas of authority and responsibility, defining the nature and extent of the agent's supervision over this large and growing problem, which strengthened ICE's assurance that management's directives are being carried out. Finally, while ICE states in its MOAs that participating agencies are responsible for tracking and reporting data to ICE, in 20 of 29 MOAs GAO reviewed, ICE did not define what data should be tracked or should be collected and reported. Communicating to participating agencies what data to be collected and how should be gathered and reported would help ensure that ICE management has the information needed to determine whether the program is achieving its objectives. I can go on. It's about 50 pages here. But I do want you to know, I do want you to realize that if ICE is not doing it correctly, I'm saying if, I don't know it to be a fact, and that causes a problem for our sheriff, who I've heard him say repeatedly, he is doing it correctly, he has nothing to hide. We want to clarify this. We want to prove, what my point is, to prove what the sheriff is doing is correct, not to prove him incorrect, not to prove that he's doing something wrong. That is my point. And that's what I would like to see, an audit done of the complete 287G program.
By whom?
Preferably the government, GAO, because they're the ones that have been after ICE.
Are you putting that in form of a motion, Ms. Vaughn?
I would like to put it in form of a motion, yes.
We have a motion on the floor.
I can call for it because it doesn't have to be a second.
You want to call
the question?
Call the question, okay. Ms. Vaughn, although our board does normally do a second, and we always have, she is right, it does not require a second. She has called for a vote at this time. All in favor of Ms. Vaughn's motion, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
No. Okay, that motion is defeated, okay. At this time, though, I want to call on Mr. Britt. I have spent, I've been over today, and we have some information on the 287G program, and if you'll look at his book, it's quite large, but I want to give Mr. Britt a chance to address what Ms. Vaughn has said that we're not doing. And both Eddie and I both were there today, and actually I think Mr.
Engel was there. I had court early this morning.
Okay. So. And if you will start and talk about the ICE people that are there, we do have two federal agents there, and I'll let him explain all this to you because I can't remember.
Yes, and according to the GAO report, ICE is required to conduct reviews and establish internal controls over the program. We have been visited and reviewed as late as last fall, early winter. We have two agents assigned to the Alamance County Detention Center full-time from ICE. ICE agents, they are not under the supervision, control, or anything of anybody of our office. They are federal ICE agents. They review and approve each case on a case-by-case basis. So,
Last fall?
No. We have two agents assigned to our office, and each person that is processed before a detainer can be filed or any other process taken, it is reviewed by the resident agent that is assigned to our office. I think some of the commissioners have actually spoke to those agents.
Today.
And they review each case prior to a detainer being filed. Once the file is complete, and if the detainer is filed and the case rolls over to what you call rollover to ICE custody, any state charges are finished. So now that all that's left is the ICE custody issue, the case is reviewed a second time by the resident ICE agent on site. Now, if it's after hours, holiday, weekend, it is still reviewed. They are called, contacted by phone. There's an on-call ICE agent, and they actually contact that person to review and authorize. Our deputies that are sworn through ICE to enforce the 287G program only have the power to detain, to file a detainer, and it has to meet certain criteria. And it has to be approved by the agent on site. So this is reviewed every day on a case-by-case basis. Like documented objectives, I believe was something you said. Is that correct? We do have documented objectives and a protocol that we follow that actually spells out within our department the role and function of each person within our 287G program. It spells out the function of the lieutenant, what his duties are, to review and move forward, the sergeant all the way down to the agent. I have copies of that, and that is something that we were planning to provide to the ACLU later this week. Like internal controls, I think was another comment you made, that of the 20 of the 29 MOAs that were reviewed, was one of those Alamance County by chance?
It didn't specify.
Okay. We do have internal controls because each case is reviewed case by case. And like I said, there's two agents who are assigned and do that on each and every case. There's a second inspection that is performed additionally. There is what's called a jail inspection, which is performed by Department of Homeland Security. And this is where they come in and spend 2 or 3 days on site at our detention center, and they review, it's a pretty intensive review, and they review everything from the food that's prepared to temperatures and the size of rooms and access to law libraries and access to complaints. They also review if there's been any complaints filed against our detention staff, any acts of retaliation or any type of problems they've had with staff. They actually come in and review every bit of this stuff. We have had a review in February and March of 07. We have also had a review in August of 08. Both of these inspections, copies can be obtained from ICE through a Freedom of Information Act request. That is not ours, but we have been told by ICE that all you have to do is file a Freedom of Information request to get that, to get those inspections.
But those inspections are audits, Tim.
Those are inspections. The agents assigned do reviews and control each case on a case-by-case basis. The detention center from Department of Homeland Security is an inspection. And the reason one was done in February and March of 07, the August was the 08 one was done in August. We don't know when they're coming. They show up, we're here to do your review. So we also have that review going on at the same time.
All right, question.
I'm ready.
Sure.
If I call him Tim, it's not disrespect. I've known him since he was a teenager, so that's where I am. Was there an audit done on the 287G program?
We have reviews, and I don't want to get caught in the middle because I think we get caught now counting to the fraction, to the infinite decimal. So what you're calling an audit and what I'm calling an audit, I don't know your answer. But we are reviewed daily. We have on-site staff that review each case, case by case.
No, but did the federal government come in and do?
Yes, the federal government does.
I don't mean the ones that are stationed here.
Well, they're doing that. Additionally, we have been visited and reviewed externally by ICE. And once again, in contacting ICE, the sheriff spoke with ICE today. They said that anybody would like to request that information can make a Freedom of Information request through the federal government for any of that information. But yes, we have been reviewed externally as well by them.
Can you tell us what was done? I mean, the outcome of that, or
well, we still
have to go through.
We still have a program that they seem to be pleased with. Those that spoke with our folks, we're not having any problems that I'm aware, and we're continuing to operate and move forward.
I did speak with Jill today, and is there any way you can read any of that about the audit there, or that is what they're saying we can't release?
They're saying that it simply needs to be requested through ICE, but I mean, I will be glad to show thickness of one such review. The review starts right here. As you can see, Department of Homeland Security. It goes to the purple tab. That's one.
And it was all nice.
That was two. That's two reviews, 07 and 08. And actually, my understanding as government officials, any one of the county officials, Mr. Albright has had the opportunity to review it. Any county official in their official capacity can review it. A public request has to be made through ICE. Be glad to, any of the commissioners would like to come sit down at the office and review it.
Which we,
I mean, it's there. We have nothing to hide.
I have already read
it. And I know Tim and his group have got a stack, a table full of paperwork ready for ACLU or whoever to come look at with all the citations.
Absolutely.
So, and it's my, and I actually spoke with Jill, who is the supervisor from the federal government today, who says that our agency is doing probably better than most of the other agencies in the nation in that way.
And I think that's a pretty good auditor review, if I may speak freely.
So that.
You're going to open the floor up to clapping, can I speak? I want to make sure y'all understand the difference between 287G and the stop difference.
Well, we do, but at this point, it's not open for discussion at this point.
Him up.
Well, that's because he has this stuff. So, well, he basically was, because Mr. Sutton is going to be next to talk about it because it is related to this same thing. Well, it falls under that, and if you'll hold on, I will let you comment. Okay.
And we're going to have, as I promised in my previous meeting, by your next meeting, you will have a spreadsheet of all our traffic stop data. And we'll be glad to present it. And
okay, is that the same thing, Tim, that you have on the website? I haven't honestly gone to it yet.
What is on the website is January, February, March of this year. What we're trying to do is go back to the discrepancies. And as I said before, we underreported, but I'll be glad to kind of report that I think Ms. Rozelle underreported to the Times News, and we'll have those figures for you in 2 weeks.
At this time, I'm going to recognize Mr. Sutton.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Clearly, Tim Britt's comments, and I feel mine, and a resolution that I am going to offer, clearly it's germane to the topic that was on the agenda, which was, of course, item 7, discussion of possible review of Sheriff's Department. The purpose of me wanting to introduce a resolution is mainly, the issue was forced in that we've had people come before us in this term, during this seating of this board at meetings, and they've clearly stood at the podium and they've made statements that this seating of the board did not approve 287G. That was a prior board. And prior members of this board were on the earlier board, as well as some that weren't or currently seated. But we've also had people come before us from opposing groups stating that they want 287G enforced at a lesser level than what the federal law allows. The 287G program is tiered. I'm not sure if it's three classes, two classes, I'm not sure, but it's tiered. And they want to dilute it to a degree. And that's why I'm asking for a resolution stating that we are not trying to expand it, as Ms. Gill alluded to. I'm just stating that I support implementing it fully to its fullest extent that is allowed by federal law. Now, coincidentally, it's amazing the timing of what came down the pike here at the end of the week. It's been alluded to tonight by the opposition of the program. It's been alluded to by Ms. Vaughn from the GAO report. Again, those are not legislators. Those are analysts. that the program strayed from its original intent, and I'm going to, I think, surprise. I was surprised to see something here myself today, and I think I'm going to surprise a few people with what I have discovered. This afternoon late, I was talking to a gentleman by the name of John, I'm not sure how to pronounce his last name, Ferry. You have a copy of this in front of you. It's a four-page document that was faxed in from the Center for Immigration Studies in Washington this afternoon at about 3:30. Do you have it?
Yeah,
the title of the article that he wrote Thursday, this was released Thursday, April 16th, is titled ACLU-UNC Wrong on 287G. And I got an email on this Thursday, and to be honest about it, I didn't read it. I took it over to Elon Saturday, and the print was so small on my email, I couldn't read it. So I didn't have it with me this afternoon, so we called up to Washington, and they faxed a copy that I could read better, and Pat made copies for all of you. It's four pages. Now, if you look on the back, it describes who the Center for Immigration Studies is, who this organization is. They were founded in 1985. They're clearly the preeminent organization, activist organization in the United States on this issue as far as being pro-analysis of what the issue is all about. It states here on the back, it is the nation's only think tank devoted exclusively, now some people might debate whether it's the only one, it's clearly a preeminent one though, devoted exclusively to research and policy analysis of the economic, social, demographic, fiscal, and other impacts of immigration on the United States. The author of this piece, of course, began working, you'll see, at the center in 2002. He got his BA from University of California, his JD from American University's Washington College of Law. While he was in law school, he worked for the U.S. House of Representatives Judiciary Committee, specifically the Subcommittee on Immigration, Border Security, and Claims. He also worked as an assistant prosecutor for the Montgomery County, Maryland Office of the State's Attorney. So he's not, he's qualified, to say the least, as people are on the other side. But he's definitely somebody you can't ignore. He states on the front, I'm not going to read this whole thing, but I would just like to read you a couple of sentences here. He states in his opening paragraph that the University of North Carolina School of Law recently joined forces with the ACLU and published a report, which was 152 pages long, by the way, aimed at stopping ICE cooperation with state and local enforcement. Said the paper also advocates mass illegal alien amnesty. He states that the paper, in his opinion, is full of accusations, inaccuracies, and anecdotal evidence, that it is heavy on conclusions, all of which stem to be cut and pasted by ACLU publications. He sums it up by saying, in all the paper, the study from Chapel Hill, reads more like an ACLU press release than serious academic research. Now, on the back of page 2, or go to page 2, this is what I found to be very interesting. Where everybody claims that the program has strayed from its original intent, he has a statement in here that was at a recent congressional hearing from the original author of the statute, Congressman Lamar Smith, Republican from Texas. And it says, quote, from Lamar Smith, quote, I was the House author of the 1996 immigration bill that included the 287G program, and there's nothing in the legislation that limits the program to detaining those who committed serious crimes. The goal was not that at all, he states. The goal was to enable those local law enforcement authorities who wanted to enforce the immigration laws in whatever way they thought best. And that might or might not include those who committed serious crimes. If you go to page 3, this is where I was shocked to see how important Alamance County is in this whole debate nationally. He states, he told me on the phone that Alamance County was pivotal in how this was going to be determined in the future as far as nationwide. He told me that. At least he believed that. He claimed that a lot of people are watching what happens here. He has on page 3, this went around the United States, a major paragraph about Alamance County, the wreck that took place uptown where an illegal alien ran a stoplight and killed a father on a motorcycle while his son was airlifted to Duke. Talks about our sheriff, his comments about what the ACLU has put him through. And one more sentence out of this, he says, this report is part of a broader, talking about the UNC study, this report is part of a broader ACLU effort in North Carolina to undermine state and local enforcement of immigration laws. The activist organization has threatened lawsuits, and I think we can say we've heard that, against every law enforcement agency in the state involved in 287G. And it's not just North Carolina, it's around the United States that the ACLU has mounted this fight. This article was in the Raleigh News and Observer Sunday. If you don't think this is really a pivotal situation as far as how it's being viewed elsewhere, where it's being broadcast elsewhere, Alamance, a battleground, a new. This article was in the Myrtle Beach Sun-Times as well, and on Sunday. I don't know if even the sheriff was aware of that, but it was in Myrtle Beach's newspaper because I got a phone call that it was in the paper. And it's because McClatchy News Service, that owns this paper, owns the Myrtle Beach paper as well. The blogs, and I'm not a blogger, but I did read these blogs. The blogs on the Myrtle Beach Sun-Times News said, we wish we had a sheriff like Alamance County, North Carolina, here in O'Ree County, South Carolina. It was blog after blog after blog. Everybody that blogging was, and prior to this article, being in the Sunday paper at Myrtle Beach, they had arrested 8 to 9 gangbangers who were illegal aliens 2 days before that. Myrtle Beach is having a fit with this issue. I understand that there's possibly some consideration about whether we sign a resolution versus a verbal support mechanism. I'll be quite honest about it. Had I thought that something was coming forward first, verbally, I wouldn't have tried to be forceful to force a signature on a resolution, but that's not the case. I thought nothing was coming forward, so I did have our county attorney draft a resolution. I don't think I need to read it, but the resolution states that we support our sheriff's department, and we also support the implementation, his involvement, the sheriff's department involvement with the 287G program as allowed by federal law. And I offer that as a motion.
I'll second that.
Point of order. Thank you. I would like to know whether Commissioner is referring the paper that he got from Washington as an official document, or whether he's just a think tank.
I think I made that clear when I described who they were.
It was not an official document, you said.
No.
So I wanted.
I made
to make
it clear that it was an activist organization, and that their attorney.
I mean, they're no more. They're an active organization like the ACLU.
I think I made that point.
Another point.
I made that point.
But I wanted to make it clear that it was not an official document.
I didn't say that it was, and I also stated that the attorney for their organization had very good credentials, just as the other side did. Did you hear that?
I heard what you read.
Okay, well, that's what I said.
Okay. I had told him he could just make a statement.
Before you vote, I would like y'all to think and separate. I feel like if I audited 287G, they're not going to find many problems. I don't have no doubt about that. We need somehow for you people to make it clear to the public there's a 287G and there's local law enforcement. Local law enforcement is being corrupted with y'all and your politics. And in other words, you are responsible because you're saying we're against illegals. Give me your vote that encourages the sheriff that goes on that. All right, 287, you can laugh if you wish. 287G, the government part you can audit from now on, you're going to find very little harm. You audit these records from all the arrests, the stops, what happens out here on the road. You may get a different story. I hope not, but that's what I was trying to finish up saying a while ago.
Okay.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, I know we've got a motion and a second. I think if I could, or one of us, and I don't mind, if you could read this, I think it would clarify what we're voting on here, and everybody would understand. This is a resolution for Alamance County to fully support the ICE program of the Department of Homeland Security and the Sheriff's Department in the implementation of ICE program under the 287G jail enforcement model. Whereas the United States Immigration and Customs Enforcement, ICE, is a component of the Department of Homeland Security, DHS, and whereas the ICE mission is to protect national security by enforcing the customs and immigration laws of the United States by a program known as 287G through memorandums of agreement, local law enforcement under the determination of the immigration status of all arrestees may be made by the sheriff, and whereas effective January 1st, 2008, North Carolina General Statute 162-62 also requires the sheriff as administrator of the county jail to determine the legal status of any person charged with a felony or an impaired driving offense when that person is confined in the county jail. And whereas Alamance County fully supports the federal and state laws and the implementation of the federal and state laws by the sheriff under the 287G jail enforcement model in North Carolina General Statute Section 162-62. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, the Alamance County shall continue to fully support the 287G jail enforcement program and its complete and continuing implementation by the Sheriff's Department in Alamance County. Number two, the Alamance County shall support the Sheriff's Department as they follow the guidelines of the Immigration and Customs Enforcement component of the Department of Homeland Security and the Sheriff's Department implementation of the 287G jail enforcement model. Three, this resolution shall become effective upon its adoption this 20th day of April 2009.
And I want to make a comment. I want to make a comment here. When I was asked to sign this, I said I will not sign any paper that says that I support the sheriff, okay? I do support the sheriff. I support the 287G program, but I have 25 other departments that I also support. And therefore, as long as I don't see any criminal activity going on, I will continue to support these departments. And that's what I feel like as a county commissioner that I have to do, is to support every department here. Now, when I find something that is wrong, I will address it just as I am addressing the revaluation, because I think there is a huge problem there. And I have not seen it. I've been over at the Sheriff's Department. I've seen everything that they do. They've got stacks and stacks of paper laid out for the ACLU to go through. I've seen this book. This book has everything, and it shows the decline, actually, of the people that are processed through the ICE program from the first year down to this past year. I have not seen anything that... I have not found anything. If I do, I will certainly be on him like white on rice. And that's just my comment about it. And I wanted to say that to all the departments, that I'm not going to target any department. I'm going to support every department as long as I find out, as long as I see and think in my heart that there is nothing wrong. Yes, sir.
Madam Chair, brief comment. Would the commissioners consider supporting the Equal Protection Clause of the United States Constitution as well?
Well, if you bring that to us and let us look at it, I have no idea what it even is, okay?
Thank you.
But if you bring it, I understand the Equal Protection, but if you bring it here, we will look at it.
I will be glad to do that at the next meeting. Thank you, ma'am.
Just okay. Get on the agenda.
Yeah.
Okay, my question to you is, this resolution was not on the agenda, so I call point of order.
Well,
I've stated that it's germane, and I don't know.
What
it's you know, I guess it's a matter of opinion, but if you don't think it's related to the topic, I don't know what could be.
Well, I was ruled out at the last meeting because I was not on the agenda for it.
You didn't have it was germane to the agenda item.
There was no discussion on the floor at that time.
You have a second on the motion?
I do. I have a second.
Can I make one statement? Yes, sir. And it was very enlightening to me to go to the sheriff's office today, and I don't know how many, I don't know, have you been in and to see the stacks of papers they have for the ACLU tomorrow?
No.
Well, you're welcome to, Sheriff.
I'm sure.
I feel certain would welcome you over there. And if you get permission from the federal government, you file the Freedom of Information Act, you can have that too, boy. anyhow, I think the sheriff is very forthcoming with his information to us as commissioners. And the sheriff was elected by the people to do the laws of the United States of America and the state of North Carolina. And I think he is using tools he has been given. And I just got one word to say to the people that feel 287G is not a fair program. Spend your time in Washington.
Right.
And don't spend it here in Alamance County, because we are wasting the valuable time of our deputies over there.
Here, here.
Because ICE is looking after every document that goes by that they file for deportation. They're looking at it twice. So the program is being implemented as it is, and I don't see that there's any profiling in there.
No. Okay. Enough is enough. Okay, that's good. We do have a motion and a second. All in favor of the resolution say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay.
What was the vote count on that?
4-1.
4-1.
Okay, the next thing is the county manager report.
Thank you, madam.
Please have order, okay?
What's going on out there?
All right, go ahead, Mr. Hunter.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. First, let me say it's been a very busy 10 days, and I'm glad now to be in double digits on my days of employment. We've had some very good meetings with department heads, trying to work on the budget, but also trying to get out and visit the sites and visit, you know, the county facilities. So I do appreciate the department heads and working with me on that and the scheduling. Just a couple things to bring you up to date. At our next meeting, which will be May 4th, you will be presented the manager's recommended budget that will be given to the board at that time, and we'll have a presentation. At that time, we'll also ask you to set a public hearing for the May 18th meeting. Again, we don't have to approve the budget at May 18th, but we'll just set the public hearing at that time. So
okay.
We'll have that public hearing then. Also, just to let you know, at our next meeting as well, we're going to bring you an update on our capital projects. We're looking at different options of funding, but also looking at options of possibly moving forward a little bit quickly with interest rates right now being historically low. And contractors being very hungry, so we, you know, want to take advantage as much of that as we can. And Tim will make that presentation along with the architects next meeting. But other than that, I have nothing else, unless the board has any questions.
Anybody have any questions for Mr. Hancock?
That's enough.
If not, we'll move on to the consent agenda. Does anybody have any questions on the consent agenda? Anything that needs and wants. Everybody okay with that?
Everything's
good. Okay. Motion. I entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda.
Second.
Okay. Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. At this point, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143. 318.11A6 to consider the performance of an employee. I entertain that motion.
Madam Chair,
yes, sir.
I'll support that obviously, but is it, can we request that our personnel director be with us on this?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Human rights.
And attorney.
Sheriff.
And is that feasible?
An attorney.
Yes. The attorney.
Yes. Yeah, we can.
And attorney.
Yeah.
All right.
Yes. Yes. So they will be.
Okay.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion.
I have a motion. All in favor? Okay. I need a second on that. Do
second.
I get one? Okay. Thank you. Okay. At this point, we will go into closed session.